You're gonna start.
I'm gonna start. Anyways, so yes, we are honored to be here. Really, seriously, it was a pleasure. It's been a pleasure reconnecting with Carl, and
we're getting situated.
Yeah. We've got an interesting story. I mean, Regina and I, obviously, we've been married. We were going to be 35 years Monday. And it's just been amazing.
Going to Disneyland.
Yeah. What else do you do on your 35th birthday? I mean, anniversary. But anyways.
What?
He took my phone.
He needs that, I think. Dear God, bring it back.
Bring somebody here, please.
Somebody pat him down before he leaves.
Yeah, exactly.
Carl, would you? So, yeah.
We've always had a really funny relationship with him.
We were working on the church one time, and one of the other painters in the church, Chuck Winkles, who there's a whole other story with him, is sitting below, has me posted up at the bottom floor of a two-story window, and you know, he's just talking. I'm thinking, what is he doing? He's just talking to me, and I'm painting these sash windows, and he kind of does that, steps back, and boom, 5 gallons of cold water dumped over the top of my head, and there's Carl running down the hall laughing just hysterically because he just dumped 5 gallons of cold water over my head. And,
sure.
Absolutely, because I tackled him at the end of the hall once I caught up with him. Anyway, so that's our relationship. And it doesn't end there. But anyway, so John and Regina and I, obviously Regina's the author of Thirsty Heart, and it tells the story of how Regina was able to come to that point of having a dehydrated heart and having that heart become nourished via Jesus throughout our marriage. And in that process, Regina was able to extend to me the unconditional love of Christ, to where she was able to lay down her life and be a bridge. And a bridge is, you know, you think of a bridge as something you walk over. It's not a pretty picture when you think about it if you're the bridge. But she was able to become a bridge, with Jesus being the support system under her, to allow me to truly come to know Christ after pretending to be a Christian, in my words, that I'm pretty sarcastic about it.
That's right.
But pretending to be a Christian for so many years and really not knowing Christ. Because the thing is, I knew about Jesus, but I truly didn't know Jesus. I'd experienced seasons in Jesus, but I really wasn't, we weren't tight. We weren't, you know, we didn't have that communication that, you know, so many of us long for. So we're gonna give you a little bit of our story from the beginning, so you can understand where things started from. For me, I started out. I was born, obviously, a lot of us are the same age. I was born in, you know, the early '60s, '61 to be exact. I was the eighth child of a large family, and I was given a lot of freedom. Actually, way more freedom than I should have had. You know what? Look, you see it in stories and books where kids get to romp around out in the hills and just have lived this free life. Well, that is the life that I lived, but unsupervised, without rules, a life of lawlessness. And with that came a price. By the time I was in the fifth grade, being the youngest, and my brothers were, you know, we were into long hair and everything, I had already experienced, by the time I entered the fifth grade, I had already been drinking. I'd already been smoking weed because I'd steal it from my brothers. I'd already been involved in witchcraft. We were doing seances because I was allowed to live in a tree fort in a field next to a cemetery. And witchcraft and sex, pornography at that young, ripe age. And I know, I learned later that that is the entry point of where the enemy, you know, it opened a whole realm of darkness that the enemy was able to step in and really begin to get into me. And it stayed that way for a long time, even after my first encounter with Christ. You know, went through my life, that's what I did. You know, I was a little bit of a rebel. Actually, I was a lot of a rebel. And I did not like authority. I had authority issues, long hair, against the schools. When the school wanted me to cut my hair, I wouldn't cut my hair. I'd put it in a ponytail, wear it up, and my mom was like, yeah, you know. But I don't fault my parents any of that. That's what they knew. But then there was a night when I went to Mars, trying on acid, of course. And just prior to that, my friends that I partied with, there was two different batches that came, they became Christians, and we used to mock the Christians, and these were people that, I was like, wow, what is up with that? You know, these guys were becoming Jesus freaks, as we labeled it, and they became to know Christ. And then after I went to Mars and came back, and, you know, I had this out-of-body experience where I was like, looking at my life, and I believe it was probably the Lord, I felt it was me speaking to my, and I was like, really? So you're liking that life? You know, is that really what you want to do? And I was like, no. That I think that was probably one of my first cognizant periods of knowing how empty I was inside. I was empty and I was searching for something, because we are all searching for something. And that is when I was like, okay, the Jesus. Okay, these guys speak fire and brimstone, and these guys over here speak love, and I'm like, let's go check it out. So I dug out this pamphlet out of my junk drawer.
Tract. Do you guys remember those?
Yeah, the tracts that people would hand you that you throw away. Well, you know, I didn't throw it away for whatever reason. I dug it out, and I said, okay, how to become a Christian? And I just said the sinner's prayer in the tract. I said, all right, I'll go to church. And I caught up with my friends at church, and that was my journey into Christianity. However, I wasn't discipled, you know, but I liked it. I liked the girls hugging you. Key point.
I'm like, you just went for the girls.
Yeah. I liked the girls, you know, and just the love, the warmth, the embrace. But there was genuine love there, something that I hadn't experienced, and that's where my journey into Christ began.
Okay. So I grew up in the Los Angeles area with my single mom and my only brother, and as far as I know, it was a good life. My mom and dad divorced sometime before I came around. And
that was me.
Oh.
Don't do that.
Okay.
Profound.
You scared her?
Yes.
Profound.
Oh,
no.
Don't do
okay,
that.
Here we go. And so my dad was never really around. He lived in East Los Angeles. And we would see him when we needed money, because my mom was a single mom, so we would go to the bar where he lived and worked, I think, and, you know, get money, and then he would come every now and then. And the thing for me was, I always expected him to come, I waited for him to come, and it just wasn't in him to do it, but he promised a million things. And he did that up until the time that I was 16, and he said, when you get your driver's license, I'm going to buy you a car. And so my boyfriend and I went looking for a car. Found the car, came back to my dad, like, we found the car. It was a red Pinto. I mean, who remembers Pintos, right? It was top of the line then. And he said, I'm not going to buy you a car. I can never buy you a car. And so that was when it finally, like, hit me. Okay, done. And I didn't talk to him again until I had my son, maybe 5 years after that. But that was kind of the childhood. It wasn't always about a car. It could have been about anything. And that left a lot of rejection, a lot of pain, a lot of abandonment, and tons of fear. And so fear was kind of the thing I was rooted in. I was also sexually abused during childhood, which has, you know, a lot more stuff that goes with it. And so I think my mom, like, she never dated the whole 10 years from 0 to 10. Well, she did get married at one point early, but I don't remember that very much. And then we weren't married to him very long. And then she just never dated. Am I nervous? Okay. She never dated. And I just felt like she did a good job. And it was hard, but she was there. And first time I drank was at 7 years old. My brother, who was 12, my mom was somewhere, I don't know, and he took me out to his friend's house. We got drunk and we rode on bikes and crashed. I remember this. And so that was my introduction to alcohol. So fast forward to teenage at this point, just the approval from boys was how I found my identity. That's where I was. And I just loved the attention that I got from them. And I ended up in a serious relationship for about 5 years from ninth grade to about a year after I graduated. But I still kind of dated whoever I wanted. He was here at UCI, actually, and he dated whoever he wanted. We had this weird relationship, although we thought we didn't. We were exclusive to each other. I don't know how that works. But anyways, I got pregnant twice with him, and we ended up aborting both babies and thought we would marry after school. And then I moved up to Central Coast, Santa Maria, California, and started going to a church there, and the Lord made it pretty clear that I wasn't going to marry the guy, and because I was waiting for him to become a Christian. Mm-hmm. I asked the Lord in my heart in 11th grade, and I was very sick, and my mom took me to, at our Catholic church that we grew up in, took me to a meeting where they were, you know, praying for people, had prophetic words. It was really interesting. I didn't know what they were doing. And we walk in, and the lady's like, come over here in this corner, and she says, repeat after me, and my mom ran like, okay. And so, repeat after her, and it was a sinner's prayer. I mean, I have no clue what we were doing. And so, you're saved, good, go on with life. No, not really. So I sat, and we were sitting in the back, my mom and I, and they thought I had a brain tumor. I had very, like, high fevers, bad headaches, couldn't figure it out. I was going to UCLA for it, and the Lord just called me out. Someone went up there and said, there's someone here with these symptoms, named all the symptoms, and I don't remember this, but I sat there going, that's not me. And my mom and all these ladies in this room were like, that's you. And I was looking at him like, it's not me. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember how I got up, went forward, got prayer. My mom said, there was this glow. And my mom doesn't know what's happening, but she gets filled with the Holy Spirit right then and there. Mm-hmm. And both of us are like, this is our first day being a Christian. And so my mom was sold out. It was over. It's done. Yeah. We went to UCLA the next day, and they said, we just can't find anything wrong with her. We don't know. And my mom just raises her hand. She's like, praise the Lord. And I looked at her like, oh gosh, she's lost it. It's over for her. And so I made a deal with Jesus and just said, you know, I can't do it. I was a partier. I was a weekend alcoholic. Every weekend from Friday and Saturday, I drank either with my boyfriend or with my friends. That's just what I did. It's how I coped with life. And just knew that I couldn't give that up, and I didn't want to give it up. And I didn't want to give up my relationship with my boyfriend. And so I just said, during the time I said, if you're real, this is sitting back before I went up for it. I said, if you're real and you're here right now, then heal me and I'll serve you the rest of my life. Whoa. So then I go forward and get prayed for, go to UCLA, and I said, oh, just kidding. I really don't want to serve you right now. And I laugh. I'm like, what nerve, you know, like he could have killed me right there, but he didn't. And I said, when I graduate, I'll do it. Okay, so I graduated on Thursday, partied all weekend. My mom picks me up for church on Sunday because I didn't live with her. I get to church and Jesus is like, okay. I keep calling the deal. And I said, okay, I am absolutely ready. And it was just that day forward. Like, no turning back. Like, okay. And we moved to Santa Maria. I started going to youth group, and that's where I met him. And let's see, where am I? Okay, so now I'm going to go into our relationship. So neither of us had ever had a relationship that didn't include sex. And so it was no different when we got together. The thing was, there was so much shame and so much like heaviness, you know, guilt, rightly so, guilt, you know, because we're not supposed to be doing it, that our relationship was so like burdened all the time. We would talk like, oh my gosh, we can't do this anymore. And then the next thing you know, we did it. So I ended up pregnant. And my mom said, okay, you're going to marry next week. We're going to go to this one church, get you married. No one's going to know. And I said, okay. He was like, okay. And all of a sudden, I started to think about that. I go, wait a minute. This is my life. And I need to figure out, should I marry him? Is he the right choice? Or was it just, you know, a relationship? Because we hadn't been together very long at all. And so I told my mom I couldn't do it. And waited. We got married 4.5 months later after I was pregnant. And what I wanted was a sign from Jesus, like, should I marry him or not? And I'm a new Christian, so I don't know that he doesn't do that stuff or that he does do that stuff. I just expected that he did. And I kept saying, show me a sign. And it, literally, I would look at the signs on the side of the road waiting like it was going to marry him, don't marry him. And
that's cool.
Yeah. And then we went to lunch one day. And we were deciding what was going to happen. He was going to give me his car, and we were just deciding our separate life, how it would work with the baby. and I went home and got on my knees, and I said, and this was my regular thing, like, Jesus, what am I supposed to do? Should I marry him or not? And he said very clearly, trust me and marry him. And I just got up. I'm like, okay. Told my mom, we're getting married. And she was like rejoicing, hallelujah chorus. She was like, call him right now. And called him, and I don't remember how it went down, but we got married 6 weeks later.
6 weeks later.
And we were the shame of the church. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, that happens to people that that happens. And if you want to go in.
So that was our first experience with public shame. It was before Regina had gotten pregnant. You know, we went to our pastor in what's supposed to be private counsel and shared with them our struggle that we've been, you know, sexually active. Following Sunday at church, and there was only us and one other young couple that were dating, and he says one of our young couples has come.
And the other ones are like goody two shoes. You know, yeah,
the other couple was Ken and Barbie. You know, so nobody would. So it was obvious it wasn't them. And he just shares, you know, that we were having sex, and it was just like, and it was like, whoa, okay. So, you know, of course we're shrinking under the chair. Her mom knows it's like, not us.
Well, she's trying to believe it's not. She's helping.
And, you know, we're shrinking down in the chair. You know, we're in the front row, you know, trying to be, you know, what we were. And it was like, wow, you know. And, of course, you know, we hop in the car. And
no, he had us come forward and kneel before the whole church.
He had us come in front
but
of the
But he didn't ever say it was us. But he said that couple needs to come forward. And we're just like, gosh, how old were we, 19, 18?
At that point, we were 18 and 19.
And just new Christian, so you're going to do whatever, you know. Yeah. Now I'd be like, not happy.
Yeah, I think we would have flipped him. I think we would have flipped him the bird. Got a little more bold. Anyways, so, you know, obviously that public shame, that was another layer of something that we tried to dodge for years. And onward, Mama says, you know, was that you? And
We told her no. She believed us, I think.
And the funny thing is,
until a couple of weeks later, when I was pregnant, it was us.
In the brief period that Regina said, "No, I'm not going to marry you. You know, I'm not marrying you because you're pregnant. You know, because I'm pregnant." I was like, her mother and I hatched this secret plan. She says, "Ignore her. Everywhere you go, just ignore her. Don't pay any attention."
Because he was bringing chocolates, flowers, like almost every day, and just like, you know, can we get married? Will you marry me? And I'm just like, I need space.
Yeah, she was like, hands
off.
So
my mom's like, it's too much. You're going to she's not going to like that.
So anyways, so here I would like to think it was because I ignored her, but the true glory goes to God because God told her, trust me and marry this man.
And I needed those words. Like, in the last 35 years, those were staying words for me. It's always like, you know, you said to trust you. And I got into this because you told me to. And so we had Josh 4 months later. And this is a funny story. We're not going to tell it all. He was born 1 month early, breech in an elevator.
Oh, my God. Wow.
My introduction to having babies.
And that's pretty much how our life has always been. It's not been mild, it's not been quiet, but it's always been big and loud, and we're
weird.
Still big and loud. Yeah. You know, our kids, when we sing happy birthday, it's at the top of your lungs and as loud
screaming.
And obnoxious. I mean, we've had restaurants close the doors because we were so loud. But Josh, I mean, he was coming out at the house early.
You didn't believe me.
Yeah, I didn't believe her. Yeah, I was like, no.
We had just finished Lamaze, and they said, a woman in labor will tell you anything. So he thought that was the
because
anything.
Of the pain. Yeah, I knew, because I just graduated from Lamaze.
He was walking around with an orange trying to pack the Lamaze bag.
We go to the hospital, you know, just this wild, Mr. Toad's wild ride to the hospital with Josh, you know, his foot sticking out at the house. And the umbilical cord, and I don't believe her, and she's like, she grabs my hand and puts it there, and I'm like, you know, I freak out, I'm like, oh, it's true, you know, and to this day, she says, why won't you just believe me, you know, and I'm like, how long has it been, but, you know, they shove them back inside at the hospital, and they're going to go do a cesarean, and we're in the elevator, three-story elevator, you know, and at the second floor, you know, the door opens, closes, and I look, and he's out to his knees, and I look at the doctor, and I said, what do you say we deliver? And she says, yeah, let's do it. And before the door
then
opened,
they let me know.
Yeah,
like,
on the third
the
floor.
Elevator?
Yeah, Josh was born, and it's crazy.
And this is prophetically speaking, who Josh is.
Right.
This is what we always say: you're always one foot out the door, and he really is.
And on
that's how he lives his life. Just going, going, going. And then our second to the last child, Parker, he took 15 hours, and that's how Parker lives.
Really.
We're like, there's just one speed. Amazing children, adults now. Okay, where are we? Okay, so then after Josh, we had Haley. 2 years after Josh, we had Haley. We were doing good. Didn't know anything. Like, we were just starting out. We had moved to a bigger home and remodeled it, and we're kind of just doing our thing. He was working. I was working. I had a career. And we had our daughter, and she had to go to childcare all the time because I had a career. And 1 year, when she was 1 year old, I remember this clearly because it was her 1 year birthday, I found out that John had an affair. And just thought, we went to a counselor. We had just started going to Vineyard. We had just met Carl, and we were like, gosh, do we call him? Because we just met him last week, and now we're calling and saying, yeah, I need help. So I did call, got an answering machine, and then thought, okay, well, I'm going to call the church we had just been at. And then we ended up counseling with a woman there who turned out to be a mentor long decades, which we love her, Tina Jones. And she counseled us, and the one thing that I remember the most, well, what I told her was, okay, once is a mistake, and I can forgive a mistake. Like, that's one time everyone, you know, I'm fine with that. And she said, well, you're going to have to forgive him. And I remember this clearly. She told me, your jaw dropped. And I'm like, what? I did not grow up with the concept of forgiveness, knew nothing about it. Wasn't like with our kids, we're like, no matter what someone does, okay, forgive him. You know, we don't say apologize, we say forgive him. But I didn't have that as a kid. I don't even think we had the apologize word. And I remember just thinking, why? I haven't done anything. You know, and she said, she explained the whole concept of forgiveness and that it didn't matter. And later I learned that forgiveness came out as forgiveness I've received from Christ. So that was that. And Haley, 1 year later.
The forgiveness.
You're going to talk about
this. What really stuck out at that point was, this is, you know, once. I can forgive you for one, and that's it. So in my mind,
that's
like,
what I was saying.
I was like, oh crap, but she doesn't know about the other things. Okay, this is the only one she can find out. And that is where, for me, began the journey of, you know, not, I wouldn't say it's necessary because I was already doing it, but that just solidified my pursuit of hiding my sin.
Right.
Once. She can only know this one. And so I began that, you know, hardcore pursuit of keeping my hand hidden. Hidden in spite of everything, and I couldn't let her know about anything else. There's just absolutely no way.
I actually did a really good job.
Yeah.
I didn't find out until 7.5 years later.
Yeah.
Well, actually, at 7.5 years of marriage.
Right. So, voila, we move forward.
So, Haley, she's 2 years old. This is 6 weeks after her second birthday, and she was a beautiful girl, sort of greenish hazel eyes, lots of brown curly hair, very attached. One of the things I heard is, you were always holding her, and I never knew that, but I guess I was. That's kind of how I parent, just always keep them close. And the sweetest girl, she ended up having the flu, so we thought, and Monday she's sick, Tuesday she's better, Wednesday I take off work because she's sick, she's thrown up, can't stay hydrated. We take her in, they give her, you know, they said, okay, all night long you gotta give her 2 ounces of water every hour, something like that. And so we did that.
The baths.
Give her the baths for the fever, and the next day she's fine. And then the next day, I go to work, and she's going to my mom's to be babysat. She's gonna spend the night. And so Saturday, he's home before I am. And this is important to know. So that year, my brother died. What I'm telling you about, my brother died 3 months before my daughter got sick. And the year before that, like during that year, after the first time I found out, I'm a photographer, that's like my profession, and I'm always taking pictures. Well, that year, I just stopped taking pictures. It was just kind of like, I was so broken trying to figure this out, and I didn't know about healing, and no one actually, I think, even talked to us about healing. And so for me, it was just, I started wearing shorter skirts, you know, like, hey, I could do this. Started working, flirting, and I would have had an affair. I'm sure I would have if God had not saved me, because I was just like, revenge, that's a good thing. And in the meantime, it's the last year of our daughter's life, which we don't know. And for me, it was just kind of, ugh, like, life sucks. And where am I going with this? Oh, the day, that Saturday that she had spent the night of Friday, we come home Saturday. That Saturday, I was a FedEx driver, and I would do the beach cities. And I told myself that if I did the beach cities on Saturday, because you never know your route, like, because I was like a floater, then I was going to go to this guy's house that I had met on my route. And my boss says, you got the beach cities going all the way up to Cambria. I was like, I'm going. You know, I'm at lunch. I'm going to do that. And so my day was so busy, I never even took a lunch. Get off work 5 o'clock, which on Saturday you usually get off at 1. Get home, and she's sick on the couch. And he says, your mom says she's been like this all day. Like, she did not greet me. And you know how babies, they greet you when you come home. And so I called doctor, checked her diaper, dry. She hadn't been drinking. She was really dehydrated. Mm-hmm. And she said, well, bring her in. We'll put her on an IV. We'll hydrate her. And so we took her in. We had to wait for her blankie to dry because she had thrown up on her blankie and she really had to have her blankie. So we waited for the blankie to dry. And she had her hair in pigtails and we had like a beanie on her. And we're walking down. Oh, we called Carl.
Called Carl.
We didn't know him that long. We had to have dinner with he and his wife.
Maybe once or twice.
Yeah. And we called him to tell him we were taking her in. So we get to the hospital and he shows up with this, and he's wearing the Hawaiian shirt, and this, he shows up with this guy we've never met before.
His dinner guest.
And they were having dinner. They were always inviting people to dinner to their home, and he was having dinner with this guy, and he said, well, he takes the guy, the lady stays, and the kids, and they come to the hospital. And we're like, you don't have to be here. Like, it's going to be okay. We should just get an IV. And he's like, nope, I'm here. So we're walking down the hall. I'm holding her, and I feel the back of her head right here. And because she had her hair separated in pigtails, I could feel this part, and it was soft. It was like a baby soft spot.
Oh, no.
But it was soft all the way down to her neck. And I asked the doctor, I'm like, is this normal? And she said, I'll check it when I lay her down. So we get to the room. I put her down. She checks her. She lifts her head, and she starts screaming. She looks at us, and she's like, spinal meningitis.
Yeah,
and we're like, okay, because we don't know anything. And she goes, proceeds to do a spinal tap. 3:30 in the morning, we're laying there on these mats on the floor, and we hear the most horrible sound, you know, and
extreme gasping.
And I'm like, what is that sound? What's that noise? And he says, it's that machine, you know, thing. And I said, no, it's something else. I look up, and she had her eyes closed, one hand down, one hand up, and her chest was sunken in, and she was just gasping. And we're like, oh my gosh. So we call it, we get the nurse. The nurse freaks out, and she's like, oh my God, the baby. Get Donna. Donna's the RN. This nurse is an Albion. And so we're running around this floor looking for the nurse, yelling, Donna, Donna. And then by the time we get back to the room, they called a code blue.
Yes.
And we went to a side room where no one was in there. And I remember this very clearly. These blue eyes of my husband piercing, and he just slugged the floor, hard floor with this fist, and just said, no! And it was like, oh my gosh. I'm like, no, don't do this. Oh my gosh. So we call my parents. We call Carl at that point. We come out, and the doctor said she's had a respiratory arrest. She's on life support. We put her on a ventilator, and that's all they could say. So we wait for our doctor to get there the whole day. We're in the waiting room for a million years. And then they come out to say that she has a brain tumor on the whole left side of her brain. And she was consulting with a neurologist, and then a neurosurgeon's coming in, and they're going to do a shunt to relieve the pressure. So that's how we learned about it. It was a Sunday morning, and the Vineyard is where we were at church, Carl, and they did, instead of doing church, they did a prayer service for her the whole morning. And then when that was over, the whole church came to the hospital. And there's people down the halls, in the waiting rooms, just everywhere. And people we didn't even know, and just there, just praying and waiting. And she got out of surgery, and we're waiting for the doctor to tell us, like, what's happening. And we said, well, what's going on? And he says, well, the longest she would have to live is 8 years. And we said, does that mean she would get radiation, chemo? What does this mean? And he's like, you know, he was kind of vague. I'm like, okay. So our doctor tells us that when she's stable, they will helicopter her to Children's Hospital in LA. So that's Sunday. She said, when she's stable. So at 3:30 on Monday, prior to that, Carl sits down with us and says, bring your bill book to the hospital. And we're like, what? And he's like, we want to pay all your bills. You don't need to be thinking about this right now. Just bring it. Let's do this. And we always laugh. We're like, well, there's some late notices in there. This is kind of embarrassing. And he's like, oh, yeah, when they get pink, it's the time to pay them. And so it's kind of a joke.
Yeah.
And so we sat there in the hospital and did that with him. And then the doctor says, okay, we got a helicopter. It'll be here in 15 minutes. And she's going to Children's Hospital. And I looked at her and said, but wait a minute, you said when she was stable. And she said, and our daughter is on life support. She's in ICU. She can't keep her eyelids open. They have them taped. She can't keep her body temperature. They have her on a pad. She, you know, was not awake at all. And her heart would go really high, go really low. And so she tells us, this is as stable as she'll get. So that's for me when the reality hit, like, oh my gosh. Like I said, you said stable. She goes, this is it. And so that was like, oh, okay. We had an idea of what was going to happen at that point. Mm-hmm. So, the church buys us tickets, me, John, our son, and my mother, and we fly into LAX, and someone from the Santa Monica Vineyard is holding up a
Santa Monica rally,
a sign, you know, for us, and takes us to the hospital. We get there to the prayer room at Children's Hospital on Sunset, and
it's packed.
It's packed with these people we don't know, never seen them
just
before.
An example of the love of Christ through the body.
They're all from the Santa Monica Vineyard, and my godparents met us there. She goes, who are these people? I'm like, I don't know, but they're just here praying. And so we go in, and she got there before us. They had already assessed her. And the first thing they say is, there's nothing we can do. And we looked at them like, I said, well, we brought her here to die. And he said, I said, no, I know God, and I know that he can heal her. And that's what we're believing here. And he's like, okay. And he may have said other things, but I don't remember. And we go, they give us a place to stay. Like, it's a living room and has bedrooms off of it. It's not Ronald O'Donnell House or anything. It's just in Children's Hospital. And so our church starts coming. Carl, his wife, friends, people, a lot of people we did not know. His family, my family. And my friend, I grew up in the LA area, people that I knew that were still close to came, and there's the waiting room just packed. And some other doctor comes in and says, so we're gonna do a test in the morning to see if there's any brain activity. And if she's brain dead, we'll have to unplug her. And we just like, we have no choice. Like, if we don't get to make the choice, he said, nope, if they're brain dead, then that's the choice right there. And then someone comes in half hour later.
Pursuit of the organs.
So we would like to take her organs. So we're just like,
what?
Yeah, we've only been there a couple of hours. And
that's charming.
It's like,
They were quick.
Our first answer was no.
No,
can't do that. And she's not dying in my mind yet anyways. And so they were going to do the test at 8 o'clock in the morning. And so all night, it was just, everyone was awake. It just felt like a zombie room in the halls. I remember going down to the cafeteria. But we were with Carl and our son, who was 4 years old at the time, and in one of the side rooms where he was sleeping. And I remember I was on my face, just at carpet. I didn't care how dirty the carpet was, and just being like, Jesus, 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 could you please? And then I saw a vision of Jesus holding Haley, and they were sideways. And she was limp, and she was 2 years old, limp in his arms. No, she was a baby, and just limp. And I said, could I have her? Would you bring her back? And I said, but I want her whole. I don't want her like that. And then the next part of the vision is he turned his back to me, and she had her back, and they were holding hands, and she had pigtails, and she was running. And that was one of her issues. She couldn't do inclines, and she couldn't really run. And so the new her going up, leaving with Jesus, was running, bouncy pigtails. And I knew then before the test that it was over, that he was going to take her, and I just told them, this is it, this is what's going to happen. So even before they did the test, we said goodbye,
mm-hmm.
Everyone. Wow. We got to hold her, and they took, you know, we sang Jesus Loves You, because
mm-hmm.
that was her favorite song. I sang it to her all the time, and Carl did like a Bible reading. All of our family was in the
mm-hmm.
room, and we had to wait all day before they could harvest. So then we have to walk around the hospital trying to figure out, well, what are we going to give them? Are we going to give them the heart? And give, you know, what? How should we do this? And so we concluded that if it were our daughter who needed it, we would want someone to give it. And then just said, you know what? It's not over. Even if we, they wanted her liver. Even if we gave her liver, if Jesus is going to give her a new brain, he can give her a new liver too. So like we're still hoping for the best. Like, okay, maybe
last
this.
Last minute. Hoping for a last minute.
Like it's still going to happen.
Revival.
And so there was a 2-year-old Hawaiian boy and at UCLA Medical Center just across the city whose sister had died of a liver disease, who needed a liver, and he was on his last leg.
Mm-hmm.
And so we said yes to the liver, and they took a bunch of other stuff, and the liver went to the Hawaiian boy.
Yeah.
So at the end, John went and told them what they could do, how they could do this. And I think back now, I'm like, why didn't I stay with her to the very end? I don't know. I was not all there, I guess. But we went to go eat, and our youth pastor from when we first met was there. He stayed with her, and we got a call. We went with Carl to go eat, and my parents, they thought we were crazy because we were laughing. As we were telling you guys last night, we just were laughing, and I guess it's just a release. I don't know. Everything was funny, and we were in the middle of the night, found ourselves at Denny's, 2 in the morning.
Let me tell that.
Go ahead.
So, we'd given them permission to take the liver. They actually harvested a lot more than that, we found out later. And the Hawaiian boy, we didn't find out actually who it was going to until later, or we got a letter saying that, you know, it was a successful harvest, it was a successful surgery. So that gave a bit of, you know, hope of knowing that our daughter's death was not in void, but that her life carries on in somebody else. But as we were walking out of the hospital in what I would call a state of defeat, you had to have these badges that gave you authority to be in the hospital. And we were walking out, and there was a guard at the desk, and we're laying our badges, we're turning our badges in and laying the badges at the table. And as we step out, because it needed to be a quick surgery, we step out, there's this reverberation of a helicopter in the air between the buildings. And we step out and we look up, and it was just, you know, I think, you know, I believe it was the Lord was giving us a moment to see what was taking place. And this helicopter rises up off of Children's Hospital, comes out and just hovers above us for a moment, and just boom, and just takes off in the direction of UCLA.
Really low.
And what we knew was that Haley's liver was in that helicopter and was being taken to that recipient. And we were just like, wow, it's done.
Well, he and Carl looked towards the UCLA just thinking, okay. But my heart, I looked towards the hospital and just said, oh gosh, that's it. It's over for her. But at 3:30, we got a call from our youth pastor and said they had taken the last thing. He saw her go to the morgue. And but when the phone rang, my heart jumped. I thought, Jesus, you did it. You healed her. She's waiting for us to come back. And it didn't happen. But so started that journey. And I just want to say something about your pastor. That it's an amazing man. That he walked with us so close, was there just so continually before and during and after. And so tenderhearted and kind, and exactly what we needed. Our family was a little mad because, like, this guy's taking the place we should have. We're like, no, this is exactly the way it should be. We really didn't know what was happening. You know, it was a 4-day event. We go home, and all of a sudden, it's over. There's a bedroom. There's toys. There's a high chair. Oh, that's right. Someone put the high chair away, put the baby shampoo away, all the toys. Everything of hers was gone from the house. So we walk in, and there's no sign of her. I was furious. Went and just got it all. No, I have to have it. And set it all back out and just thought, when I'm ready, I'll get rid of it. But not for now. So we did the whole...
It was a slow process.
Yeah, we did funeral and the whole deal. Okay, where are we? Let me look at my notes.
All right, here, we're coming up to Paul King pretty soon, but a little inside story on that. My sister, right there in Santa Maria, picked up on something. She's in the medical industry. She looked at the shunt, and she approached it, and she said, why is that shunt not monitored? And they were like, they like panic hit them for a minute, and they stepped back, and they were like, and they just, you know, they just kind of shoved her aside, and they ignored it. My sister bugged the crap out of us for the next 2 years. She said, John, something went wrong. Something's wrong. They didn't follow procedure. And it turned out that, yes, our daughter was going to die. You know, it was an inoperable, one in a million brain tumor. However, the doctor assisted it. What happened was the doctor, by doing the shunt versus a CAT scan.
Doing the spinal tap.
I mean, by doing the spinal tap, it crushed her brain and caused her death to be instantaneous.
Yeah.
And then the hospital covered it up.
The neurologist, the neurologist,
the doctor, everybody. Because Regina ran into a nurse, the nurse, less than 2 years later at a Tupperware.
At a home party, and
party of some kind, and said, you know, I recognize you. She said, I was your daughter's nurse. And she said, this is what my sister's telling me. He said, yes, it's true. Okay. And it was just like, wow. You know, and again, we look at the hand of God, because then we looked at that, and so we got the information, we got the records, we had a winning case to sue them. But we looked at it as the mercy of God that Haley did not have to go through chemo, that she didn't have to suffer. She was already suffering, but that God allowed it. We credit it to God. We talked with Carl, and it's like, was it going to bring her back? No. Was it going to, you know, is there anything good that could come out of pursuing a lawsuit? And we talked to the doctor actually in person, and she totally, she had a private one-on-one, and I said, did you screw up? Did you, you know, textbook says you're supposed to do this and you did that. And she said, yes. She admitted it, you know.
And she cried. She
and
was
cried.
So
and
sad.
We just, we said, well, we'll get back with you on that. We had a lawyer that said, this is a winner. And we said, no, we're not going to do it. We chose not to.
It was kind of Carl's advice. He's like,
yeah, it was
you
Carl's.
Don't want, yeah, just watch the last 2 years. You certainly don't want to go through a lawsuit. And we kind of just took that to heart and said, yeah, you're right. It was, life was hard enough. So we didn't. What I want to say about Haley is that her name means hero of grace.
Aww.
And we didn't know that when we named her. Anne was my mom's middle name, and I don't even know how we picked Haley. We just liked it. And so even now, that just rings true in our hearts all the time, that she was the hero of grace. My healing from that, I was in a women's group, and they would pray for people every, you know, it was on a Monday morning. And I remember I would not get prayer because I thought, this 5-minute prayer, so I can do the trick for me. And I didn't want to be that person. It's like, I need prayer. So then finally I asked him, I said, okay, I really need to start getting prayer, but will you walk with me? I'm going to need prayer every week, and I don't even want to have to ask for it. Could we just make this like a staple? So one girl would grab the Kleenex and say, let's go, you know, and we would, they would pray for me. That happened, that was for about a year. And then one Sunday morning, well, this is what was happening. Every time I would go to church and there was worship, or go to a small group and there's the presence of the Lord, I only could cry, like uncontrollable cry. And so I thought, I just can't be in that situation, because then everyone's like feeling sorry for you and trying to give you advice about how much better you are, because, or how much better she is. And you're just like, oh, you know, I don't want your advice. I just, you know, shut up and hug me. And so one Sunday morning, the word was, it was an altar call. And of course, Carl's preaching. And they said, there's people here who are shaking their fist at God, who are angry with him. And I knew that that was me. And I went forward, and the Lord showed me myself just shaking my fist at him. And he spoke something to me that changed the way that I viewed life, and I believe set inside me a willingness to do the hard stuff. He said, why don't you shake your fist at the enemy, where it will do you some good.
Right.
Yeah, that's good.
And it was a huge revelation. It's like, that is right. And when things happen, people blame God, but that just puts them in a worse spot of, you know, now you don't even, you know, you can't access him in the way that you should. And so since then, in our marriage, with our children, it's always been, you know what, Satan? Thus far and no more. I'm not doing this with you. You're not, you have no control. So somewhere in the mix, that set me in a place to stand. And by the grace of God, believe me. Okay, so here we go. After that, we had Charles. 1 year later, after Haley died, we had Charles. Mm-hmm. Amazing man. He's 29 now. Mm-hmm. Gosh, we're like, God, these babies get so big. And when Charles was 2 years old, we were doing our life. John was doing his thing, which I did not know about. And I was a stay-at-home mom at this time. When we had Charles, we decided that we would live each day as if we didn't have tomorrow, which meant if we only had to live on one income so that I could be home with the babies, then we were going to do that. We started homeschooling. And I like that because then I could be with my kids all day long. I didn't like teaching. That was like the hard part. But but I like being with them.
Just make cookies and count the measurements as math.
I'm one of those, but I did do school. Even if they, someone to college. But so then we are going through life like no big deal.
Unresolved issues.
And then our church is having 6 months of people coming. Like, these amazing people are coming. Mike Bickle, Rick Joyner, Bob Jones, Dave Parker, Ken Blue. All these people are coming to Santa Maria. John Paul Jackson, Ed Piork, coming to Santa Maria. Little Santa Maria. It's a blip. It's a cow town. And we're having all these meetings. And that's kind of when my heart started to change. The messages, something was happening. And I actually, that's when I was Christian 10 years, that's when I started reading my Bible on a daily basis and getting up and seeking the Lord. And it was just all new. And so there was all this buzz about Paul King, and he can read your mail. And, you know, people are just blown away. We're watching video and of him, and he's right on and all this stuff. And so I asked the Lord, I said, okay, I knew he was coming to our church. I said, I would like him to tell me why Haley died. And everyone would say, you don't need to know. When you get to heaven, you won't need to ask why. And I'm like, I want to know. I had that right, I think. And so I just asked the Lord, and I had this vision of Paul walking towards me, and he's carrying a gift, and he's walking really, really fast. And the gift just explodes when he got to me. It just, like, exploded. And I was like, oh, okay. So then he gets there, and we have our first meeting. And I'm selling tickets. We're just like, have no idea what's coming. And
we're doing our Christian duty.
We were absolutely
in
doing
the house.
It. And we sit down, and the message was on the jealousy of God. And I'd never heard that before. And it struck me hard. And my mom says after, let's go out for coffee. I'm like, I can't do that. I have to go home. I have to process that. Like, this is something. This is, like, I've never known this about God. And we go home, and he's getting ready to go to work because he goes to work at 4 a.m., getting his clothes ready. And I'm sitting on the edge of the bed, and I ask him a question about the meeting, about the jealousy of God. And he answers some empty, long crap.
Bull
nothing.
Crap.
He doesn't know what he's talking about. But that's the first time I see it. And I'm like, Jesus, why am I changing? You're changing me this whole 6 months. And he's not. And one word, he said, secret.
Whoa.
And I went, oh, gosh.
Right.
We'd already had one secret, one mistake. And so I was like, okay, well, kind of knew what that meant. And so I told him, the Lord told me you have a secret. He gets out of bed, starts getting dressed. And I'm like, what are you doing? And he says, when you know the secret, I can't live here anymore. You won't let me live here anymore. It's over. And I said, get back in bed. Tell me this secret. So in the dark, laying there, he proceeded to tell me 7.5 years of secrets.
Wow.
We had been married 7.5 years.
Whoa.
Yeah.
And he actually didn't tell it all to me.
Right.
I found out some later. But we called Carl, and Sonia, Carl's wife, came over. Carl's wife came over and stayed with me, and go ahead.
Yeah. So the prophetic movement's rolling through. And pardon my sarcasm about the Christian duty, you know, all that. But, you know, because I'm so done with it now, being that, you know, I sat in church pretended to be a Christian. I did the moves, but I really, like you'll hear me say it time and time again, I really did not know Jesus. Even though I was experiencing seasons where God was obviously doing stuff, I still, in my heart of hearts, did not know him. So the prophetic's coming. I'm watching Regina change with each visitor, with each guest, because of the fact that she took the charge to shake her fist at the enemy, to shake her fist at the enemy instead of God. And yet I'm just like, don't you know, but I know that reality is about to hit. I know that with every altar call I go up and I say, only you, Lord, am I going to let know about my sin, only you. And but I just refuse to bring my hiddenness into the light. I refuse to let, and I basically said, I will run before anybody knows who I truly am.
And he was planning to run. We were we were getting like a $50,000 check from the sale of our house, and he was going to take it and leave.
Yeah, I was going to bail.
We got the check 3 days after we got the word from Paul King.
Yeah, I was waiting for the check, and I was going to split. So then Paul King comes, and it's like, and I'm like, oh crap, because she's changing. And then here comes tonight, and I know, I remember that moment. I saw it in her eyes. I saw the Spirit of the Lord speak to her and wow. tell her. And it was just like, oh no, wow. Oh
it's
no.
I'm exposed.
My secret's been blown. And I did. I gave her bits and pieces, and she said, oh no, we're not doing that,
Yeah, it was like, we did that last time, and he said one thing. Yeah, a couple of years then.
But I was leaning on, the one, only the one.
So it's like, I'm not telling you what he said. You're going to tell me.
Right. And so I did, and I went to Carl, and I was going to bail. I was going to leave. I went to Carl and Ralph's. I'm parked outside. I'm at this moment. Ralph was our associate pastor at the time. And I'm just sitting in the car, and I'm going to run, and I think it's a proverb that talks about, the man of flight when a man flies, yet no one's chasing him. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to run, and I see Ralph come outside and stands in the street and kind of looks, and he's like, okay, here we go. And I step out and I come in and I talk to him. And him and Carl, we go into Ralph's house.
The first thing he says to Ralph is, I just want to run.
Yeah, I said, Ralph, I really don't want to do this. I just want to run. And he says, don't do that. That's the enemy speaking to you. Just sit still. Let's do this. So I shared with them a little bit, and they just said, here's the plan. Tomorrow we're going to meet. You go to work. We're going to meet at the office, and you're going to have to tell us everything. Mm-hmm. Nothing left hidden.
On tape.
On tape. And we're going to record it, and then we'll figure out where to go from there. And so I go to work. I have to go by the house,
pick
up clothes.
You have that note paper in your pocket.
Yeah, it was a piece of cardboard. In the produce industry, I worked for Vaughn's, and so I would cut little pieces of cardboard to write notes on. So I wrote notes all day long, and I was just like, God, okay. What is it? And I went as far back as I could, and I wrote every sin that I could think of, everything that was substantial, and just wrote it. And this thing was just covered with notes. And met with Ralph and Carl.
Carl calls me about 3:30 and says, I don't know. I'm like, what? And he says, I don't know. He says, if you guys stay together, it's going to be a miracle. He says, I don't even know if you guys will stay together. I said, well, does he love me? And he says, he does. And I said, my whole life's a lie. He goes, no. You've been lied to, but your life's not a lie. And he says, but it will take a miracle. And I just said, well, then I'm going to have a miracle. And he's like, but you don't understand. You're going to need a miracle. I know. I'm going to have a miracle then. And he's like thinking, she doesn't get it. And he used to always say, I think it's in Peter, and it says, love covers a multitude of sins, and he always used to say that, do you have enough love to cover the sin? And so that's what I told him. I said, I have enough love to cover his sin. And he said, all right, come to the meeting tonight. If Paul doesn't have a word for you, I'll get you together with him after. And I said, okay. So, and I didn't tell my mom, I had a friend living with us, didn't tell her, go to the meeting without him, leave clothes out in a bag. I got clothes out of the closet, scrunched them in small balls so they would look really wrinkly because I was so mad at him. It was the worst thing I could do to him.
That's really mean.
Kick this bag out because I'm like, you know, Miss, you have to have ironed clothes and watch up in the dryer. And so that was a mean thing. And he picks it up. I didn't even say hello to him. But all day, I knew I couldn't take my ring off. I couldn't smash the pictures because that was my first inclination. And I couldn't talk about divorce. So I sat there and listened to prophetic words that we had had. And we had had a few. And I said, God, why? Why did you even say those things if this is my reality? Mm-hmm. And I didn't stop long enough to hear what he had to say. But we end up at the meeting. And he goes alone, and I get there. My parents are like, so my husband's given name is Kevin. So my parents say, where's Kevin? And I would not even look at them. I'm like, I can't even talk to them. And I'm like, where's Kevin? Where's Kevin? I'm like, stop it. We didn't come together. It's like, I didn't even sit by my mother because I thought, you know, I can't. I'll tell her. And it's just not good. You know, I just knew I couldn't because the thing that happens in these situations is you move on, but the people you tell don't. And they hold it for a long time, and that was already my experience. And so I knew there's no telling. This is completely up to God. So we're there in the meeting. We do worship. Kevin Prosh is the worship leader. It's really great. And then he says, do you want to do the beach cover part?
I'm going to back up just a hair. So one of the things that we always did was prior to, at our house, we had 4th of July at our house, we had fireworks because where our house was, the next county over, you couldn't have fireworks. And so we called it the forest fire. And it was, you know, on average, there'd sometimes be 100 people there. And so, you know, of course, this is July 3rd. And we're canceling the party, and everybody's, why?
I can't tell you, but just don't come.
But at the meeting, so Carl and Ralph meet, they leave me in the office, and they said, you know, we don't even have permission to pray for you. We're not even going to pray for you. And they just were like, they said, just let this rest on you after I'd confessed all of my sin. Sure. And they said, we're gonna leave you here at the office and we'll come back and get you, because I didn't have a car to get to the meeting.
How'd you get to the, they picked you up afterwards?
They picked me up.
How come you didn't have a car? It doesn't matter.
I don't know. But anyways, I didn't have a car for whatever reason. So Carl's supposed to come get me, and he doesn't show up for the, you know.
He's busy whining and dining the prophets.
Yeah, he's hanging out with the prophet, you know, and doesn't and forgets. And I don't even know when he realized he forgot to pick me up.
Probably when he saw him at the meeting.
You know, and I'm like, all right, I guess nobody's coming. So I had to walk to the meeting. You know,
that's a miracle in itself, that he didn't just say, bail, I'm going to the meeting.
And you just see it as that's God, you know. So I walked to the meeting. It's packed out. It's you know, there's over 500 people there. It's just, you know, they're in overflow rooms. The seats are all taken. Right. And I'm like, and somebody, I think it was
my dad.
Huh?
My dad.
Yeah, her dad's like, here.
And there's my stepdad.
One seat at the end. Like, everybody, the row's full. I can't be by her. But I'm at this end row, and I can see Regina over here. I'm over here, and you can see Paul Kane up there, you know, speaking. So the word comes.
You want me to start, or you can start?
You can share.
So we did not have a copy of the tape. Well, we do somewhere at home, and we didn't bring it with us. So this is our best patched-up version of the word. I'm sure it was a lot better than we remember. So we're going to share it with you, but just know that it was probably better than this. The first thing he said was that the Lord showed him something the night before, and that he saw Jesus as a divine beachcomber walking along the shore, and he was picking up all these unlikely pieces that had dashed upon the rocks, and that he was putting them back together and making something more beautiful out of them than they had been before, ever been before. And then he says, and I don't want to embarrass you, but it's Kevin here. And then another Kevin stands up. There's four Kevins in one row. And he happens to be the third one back. So this other guy stands up, and he's sitting right next to the other Kevin. And our friend, who's the other Kevin, he told us the other day, he goes, I was just like, please don't call me, please don't call me, please don't call me. He goes, and then they said, is Kevin here? I'm like, you know. So his friend stands up, And Paul starts to deliver the word and realizes something's wrong. Like, this isn't right. And then Carl tells him, he's right there. The right Kevin's right there, points to him. He stands up. And where he's standing is like these floodlights. I remember looking at him, and there's just all these lights behind him. And Paul could hardly even see him. And do you want me to tell this part?
He says, I don't want to embarrass you. He said, I don't want to embarrass you, but the Lord wants to restore you, and I just want to show you what he showed me.
He says, is your marriage on the rocks?
Yes. Yeah. And he says, is your marriage on the rocks? And, you know, and so he began to share. He says, I see that Satan has put a contract out on your life. He says, he wants to kill you before your 30th birthday.
He says, he's put a California spirit on you, and he literally wants to kill you.
Yeah. He says, and I remember he says, he wants to kill you. And he said, oh God, he's got 2 years if things don't go down right here tonight. And
of course, he was 28 at the time.
Yeah.
Wow.
And then he says, you know, but the Lord says.
He says, because of what he has for you.
Because of the ministry that he has for you and Regina to do. Mm. So Satan's want to take me out of the picture because of what we're called to do.
He said he did the next thing.
But the Lord says no. So Satan's done the next best thing. He said, I see that the brother's dead and the baby's dead. And as soon as the words, the baby's dead, the spirit of the Lord fell in the room so strong that it really, literally, I think.
Because our church had been through it with us, so everybody knew.
Yeah, and the surrounding churches knew. We were at another church. We were at Foursquare having this meeting, and the Spirit of the Lord just fell in the room. And you talked to people later that you didn't dare lift your head up. You were trying to crawl underneath the carpet, but it's glued to the floor, and you can't get under the carpet. And the Spirit of the Lord is just there, and it's the power of God just moving upon you. And he says, you know, and we weren't. He says, come up front. And he let me, you know, he calls us up front.
He says, the devil wants to kill your marriage. But the Lord said, no, the life and marriage will live. And then he actually said, where's your wife?
Yeah.
And
Regina, whatever it
is. Whatever your name is. He says, vacuum cleaner. The Lord showed me as a vacuum cleaner. People our age remember the Regina vacuum cleaner.
Yeah.
And then he says, upright. And then everyone starts laughing because they have a vacuum cleaner in mind. And he says, no, it's not funny. God meant something else by it. Which happened to be a very crucial point for me later. He says, do you believe that I'm the man of God? Do you trust me? And he said, I'm telling you that the ball's in your court, that you're going to have to forgive this man for every, and he said the word, secret.
Whoa.
Yeah. Everything that's been uncovered last night. And for me, it was like, okay, like this is happening. Because I knew, like the Lord spoke that word to me clearly, and then he spoke it clearly in the when he gave the word. Let's see. He said, you must forgive this man for all the secret things that were uncovered last night. And then he had us come together at the altar. Mm-hmm. And let's see.
5 minutes
of this wailing. About 5 minutes of wailing. No kidding. And we happened to see the video probably 10 years later, and that's what's happening. There's just a wailing in the room. The presence of the Lord, like I've never seen it since.
Never experienced it again.
Never been in it up to that time. And in the video, like I have my hands in my face and I'm just crying at the top of my lungs, like the deepest, hardest cry of my life. And then after the 5 minutes, and people that we talk to, they always say that. Like we just saw someone the other day, he goes, I was there that night. People always say that to us with their eyes wide open. I was there that night. And you couldn't look up. And we were like, yeah, that's what happened. And then, so he says, let's see. He says, total forgiveness is your only way out. You must renew your sacred vows. And then he says, oh Lord, what is this? And he looks at my husband, who's named Kevin, and says, after midnight tonight, you will no longer be known as Kevin, but you will be known as St. John. And that happens to be your middle name.
Yep.
Wow.
Yep. And then he says, you can't see the forest through the trees. And you have two kids at home. For God's sakes, repent. Our last name's Forrest. And we had two kids at home at the time. And then he also said that a dozen marriages would be restored from this event.
We never shake our broken beds.
And he said that we had to renew our sacred wedding vows and that a dozen marriages would be restored. So it was an amazing, amazing thing. After we did worship, and I was on the floor next to Ralph, our associate pastor, just I was wailing. And the Lord, what he was doing was giving me a new heart. And Ralph said he asked the Lord, what is going on with her? And he said, I'm giving her a new heart. So the next day, looking in the mirror, oh, God always talks to me when I look in the mirror. And I look in the mirror, and he said, I could do this, but, you know, and he said, I'm giving you a new heart. I'm giving you a new heart. You'll be able to do it with this new heart. And it was like, okay. And then Ralph said, that's what the Lord told me. So I knew that God had given me a new heart for the journey. But we probably had a honeymoon of about a week of a bliss. 2 weeks?
I
4 weeks? I don't even know.
Probably really after we came back from Anaheim. We went to Anaheim that one.
No, because that's when that's where it was.
Yeah.
We don't know.
We had a period of time of where we really liked each other.
Or pretended to, at least.
No, we really did like each other. He pretended that he was changed. And so we end up making, this is what happened. We 2 weeks later, we redid our vows at Sunday morning at mm-hmm. our church. And a dozen marriages came up that
wow.
Sunday to get prayer.
Get restored.
And we prayed for them. The team prayed for them. But then it came to the everyday. And it was hard. I didn't know how to forgive him, how to, you know, do it. And he didn't know how to walk free. And I remember the thing that the Lord dealt with me was with pride. Because I was embarrassed that I was married to a man who was unfaithful. And what were people going to say? What would they think? And literally, I would go to the store and I felt like this. Like, people think I'm an idiot because I stayed with this guy. And, you know, because he was in a grocery store and there was a lot of unfaithfulness that happened in the grocery store. So every time I walked in, it was just like, oh, you know, knowing. And the Lord said, one day you will stand before me. And I'm going to ask you if you did what I asked you to do. Did you do it? And those people, no one will be with you. Only you. And that changed everything for me. I was like, you know what? I don't need the approval of anybody else. This is what God's called me to. And at that point, it's kind of when I dealt with that part of the pride and just said, and even now, I mean, we were talking about this yesterday. People are going to read my book and say, what an idiot that woman is. Like, you know, she's weak. Codependent, you know, whatever it is. And the truth is, I just had to do what God told me to do. And that at that point, it shifted. Let's see, I'm going to see where we are. The thing about the unfaithfulness is that John couldn't walk it out.
Right.
He couldn't walk faithfulness out just as much as I couldn't walk out forgiveness. And so everyone in our surrounding area thought that we had experienced a miracle and we were instantly changed. And we didn't want to let them down, and so we pretend we were instantly changed and just kind of faked it.
Yeah, there was an expectation now that was upon us because of the great word of the Lord. And it was a great word of the Lord. It is a great word of the Lord. What God did and is continuing to do is fantastic. However, you know, it wasn't very long after that I was like, wow, you know, my eyes are still wandering. I'm still desirous to chase other women. I'm still wanting to pursue other avenues outside of my marriage. Mm-hmm. And it was like, holy crap, what do I do now? And we didn't know where to go with it, you know, and behind the scenes, you know, she hated me, you know, at times.
Oh no, I hated you to your face.
Yeah, well, I mean, nobody
behind
else
the scenes of the church people.
Me. Yeah, you know, so behind
except
the
for my friends,
behind
yeah.
the veil, you know, she hated me. And I don't blame her. She had the right to hate me. However, now it's a whole new level of pretending.
Yeah.
That's where my sarcasm comes out.
Whoa.
Pretending to be
a Saint
this,
John. Saint,
yeah, to
he
be Saint John.
John.
Yeah, I got
to
walk out Saint John of all things, you know. Plus, I've changed my name. You know, at work, I've gone.
And everyone's asking why you changed
yeah,
his name.
So now
he's
got all the non-Christians saying, what? You're changing your name to John? What's that about? Saint John? I have even one boss, he said, I'm not going to call you John until I see it on your paycheck. Went to Social Security, went to the records, changed my name.
Wow.
You know, went through the formality of it and now had to walk out this St. John, you know. And so the weight of that is on me.
Yeah.
Now I've got to carry this thing, You know, it's like,
which
shit.
We really didn't, but that's what we thought.
Yeah. And so we continued to move forward and fake it. And so,
That was at 7.5 years of marriage. And then 7 years later, I found out about another affair. But what I didn't know is that there was stuff in between there. And we, at that point, had just had our seventh child, including Haley. So we had six kids under the age of 14. We're homeschooling them. Actually, that might have been the year they were in school. And I was like, oh, yeah, right. I'm going to leave him now. How would I do this? I have no career, you know, and I couldn't picture my children going to school knowing that we were divorcing. And like, it was just heavy. And we went to see the same counselor we had seen way in the beginning. And she said, what are you going to do? You can do whatever you want. You can leave right now. I said, no. And so I looked at it as like a blip in the screen. I'm like, you know what? I can't deal with this. Like, right there, I was probably done, but maybe it was grace. And I just like, blip in the screen, let's just move on. There's too much at stake here. And I couldn't cope with it anyways with all these children. And so we just moved forward. The Lord moved us to Idaho in 1989 because of a job. And we get there, probably first week, I realize why we're there. It's like, there's no friends, there's no family, there's no church. We were in the Vineyard for 13 years and they had seen us through the deepest, darkest times. They were always there for us, but we move and we have no church and no friends, no mama. You know, when you need a bag of groceries, you go to your mom's house. We did not have that. Nowhere to even rest during the day. You know, like you would just, for me, I would go to my mom's and just, you know, kick back on her couch and she would take care of the kids or whatever. And there was none of that. And just realized that we were absolutely on our own and that he was the only friend I had. And I was like, oh my gosh. Like, I don't even like him. And he's my best friend here. You know, he's the only one God's given me. And so we kind of struggled through. And let me see if my notes are wrong. And then 10 years after that, I found out again. No, 7 years after that, I think. No, maybe 10 years. 10 years after that, I found out again. A friend called me and told me some news about him. And so at this point, we're married 25 years. Been Christian for 25 years. And I was just pretty much done. I was like, you know, I'm done. I looked in the mirror, washing my crying face, waiting for him to get home, got all the kids to where they're supposed to be so that I can confront him. No one's home but us. And prior to that, the Lord was teaching me, because I had such father issues, he was healing. He had healed that father thing. And then he introduced me to Jesus as my husband. And I was going through that. Knowing God as a father, Jesus as my husband, and every morning he'd wake me up 4 o'clock, and I'd sit that there until 6 o'clock, and just for a year or two, and just started getting that relationship. And Jesus asked me, he said, will you be a bridge to your husband, to John? And I said, sure. Had no idea what it meant. I'm like, sure, no problem. And I thought, maybe I'm supposed to teach him about the bridegroom thing, because men probably can't get that. Yeah, I can do that. So then this day, in the mirror, crying, I said, what do you want me to do? I said, is it true? He said, yes. I said, what do you want me to do? And he said, be a bridge. Literally put my fingers in my ear. I'm like, la la, not doing that. Can't go there. And we have our conversation. It's true. He ends up telling me that he had been unfaithful the whole time, not just that one time that I was confronting him about.
I told her everything on that one.
And we slept in separate rooms. I was pretty much going to get a divorce. We have how many kids at home? Four. Mm-hmm. Four kids at home at the time. And we were running our own business. We were really busy with work. And we were in a project where we were selling our home and building like this $1 million home on the river. And this whole thing was going on. And it was our daughter's 16th birthday. And so we just had to hold it together so we could do her birthday and do life. You know, it was just kind of like just pretend you like each other. And the kids were wondering, why does his dad sleep in the spare room? And it's like, oh, you know, just working things out. Well, one day I saw my pastor's wife in the hall and I said, can I talk to you? I told her the story and she said, you know what? You need to divorce him. No one should put up with that. Like, that's ridiculous. And I'm like, you're right. I like you. I like your advice. That's good. She said, I'm going to talk to my husband and I'll have you talk to him tomorrow. He's our pastor. So I go home, I'm so excited, like I'm sad that I'm getting a divorce, of course, that my kids are going to have to go through this. But I told my two older kids what was happening and said, okay, I need you to be strong for the littles, because tomorrow we're going to tell them, the four younger. And they lost it. They were not strong at all. They just, it was all about them and how sad they were. And I was like, oh no, this is not working out how I thought. And the next day I go to see my pastor. And the first thing he says is, you already know what to do. The Lord has spoken to you.
Oh, shoot.
What did he say? Wow. And I'm like, oh no. First bubble first. And I said, to stay, be a bridge. And it basically, I know he kept talking, but I don't know what he said. The meeting was over.
He said, then I have nothing further to say.
Yeah, nothing further. This is it. And went home and told the older boys, stay in. Didn't tell the littles. And he and I got back together slowly. We just kind of dated each other. He lived in the other room and kind of just slowly mended the fence. And didn't exactly know what it meant, but that's when the Lord called me to write the book. And just, he had already asked me to write a long time ago, but I'm dyslexic, and so writing is not my best thing. And so I was like, you know, I can't do that. And he's like, you're going to do it? And he told me that if I didn't do it, he would get someone else, and that I would be judged for it. And this is over a long period of time, so finally I'm like, all right. So I was writing Haley's story, because I thought, I know this story. But then when this happened, I stopped writing, and then he said, I want you to start writing about this. And it was an amazing time, because the Holy Spirit would meet me, and it wasn't about having dyslexia or not having dyslexia. He would meet me and write through me, and I would read it after, and it's what healed me. And it was the process. And the book, the first 2 years is what I wrote the first draft. It was 22 chapters and published 8 years after that. So it was a 10-year journey, but the first 2 years was so healing. And each chapter was just pretty much what God was doing in my heart during that time. I'm probably on a rabbit trail. Let me see.
No, you're not.
Okay. Okay, so I want to read to you just one section of the book that talks about the bridge. Because this is, the name of our ministry is Bridge. And it's bridgerelationships.com, because we truly believe that Mark 12, 30 and 31 is the bottom line of what God has done for us. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Like, this is the most important thing.
And that neighbor can be your spouse, but that neighbor can also be your brother, your mother, your father, your sister. You know, the neighbor is, it's not just a marriage story, but the neighbor is those that are around you.
So the Lord told us not to box ourselves in as strictly a marriage ministry. That this word was for everyone. So I'm going to read the part about Jesus is enough, because the essence of being a bridge, what it meant for me was, when the Lord asked me, I knew that I had nothing in me to care to be a bridge. It's like, Jesus, I can't do this. Wow. And he said, exactly. Only I can do it through you. And so what that meant for me is that I had to find Jesus in a way I'd never even looked for him before. I had to make him enough so that I could be this bridge, lay my life down, and really it was lay down my rights, because I had the right to divorce. And he just wanted to know, what would I choose? Am I going to choose him? And I didn't know how, and this story that I'm going to read kind of gives the idea of how it happened.
So let me put these on.
It's chapter 5. Says, I'm sure you've heard the saying, Jesus is enough, but what does it really mean, and how does it relate to heart hydration? Essentially, this phrase sums up the words in John 6:35. Jesus replied, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Food and water are the basic necessities of life. Without them, you cannot survive. In this scripture, Jesus is saying, I am sufficient to sustain your entire life, not just part of your life, but I can take care of and fill your life as a whole. I'm adequate and have met every need and want. You can apply me, my word, my provision to all situations in your life. I am enough. How Jesus became enough. In the summer of 2006, the words Jesus is enough became more than just a cliche to me. As I mentioned in the introduction, Jesus asked me after 25 years of marital unfaithfulness on the part of my husband to not divorce him. Instead, Jesus wanted me to change my heart, make him enough for my life, and be a bridge that would make a path for my husband to find his unconditional love. Submitting my heart and life to Jesus in this situation was one of the hardest decisions I've ever made. It was the biggest turning point of my life, a place of complete surrender. During this time, I had a constant vision of what my heart and life looked like. I saw myself walking through a very dark tunnel with no light in sight. My hair was dingy and stringy, and I was clothed in torn, filthy rags. My face was covered with sores, and my head hung low. I was walking in a sewer, and the ground underneath my bare feet was covered with countless pieces of shattered glass. Day after day, I saw myself trudging through this tunnel of life, dehydrated, devastated, defeated. Jesus, in his mercy, spoke to me, saying he was the only light at the end of my dark tunnel, the light I could not glimpse yet. I knew then that I had to find him. I had to look in a way that I had never looked for him before. No more get-well-quick methods, and no more self-sufficiency. The dark tunnel represented the life I had made for myself. I knew about God, but I didn't know him personally. I did not know who I was in Christ or realize what the cross had provided for me. I did what I wanted, and therefore my life was in darkness and despair. I needed to step out of selfish living and step into the light of God's will. Even what I was wearing in the tunnel, the filthy rags, the grave clothes of self, were a representation of the me factor that I had dressed in for years on end. The me factor, that's selfishness. If you read the book, you'll read that chapter, had to be put to death. No more being my own God. I needed to trust Jesus alone. My head hung low represented the hopelessness of my heart. It was so broken, so dehydrated, that I almost believed it was beyond repair. I needed to trust my heart to Jesus' healing hands. The innumerable pieces of glass underneath my feet represented my shattered hopes and dreams. They were worthless. They were crushed. Even the good things, there would be no putting them back together. Jesus was to be my new hope and my best dream. I had come to the end of myself. Jesus alone had to be enough for me. During this time, the darkest, most hopeless I'd experienced, Jesus began to ask me some very serious questions. The first question was simple. He said, "Am I enough?" I answered, "Yes, Lord." Day after day, he asked, "Am I enough for you?" "Yes, Jesus, you are enough." Month after month, he asked me the same question. "If I never did another thing for you, am I enough? If your life never got any better than this, am I enough? If you lost everything dear to you, would I be enough?" I responded, "Yes, Lord, of course you are." He persisted until one day I answered him truthfully, "No, Jesus, you are not enough, but I want you to be." He was not angry with me. He only extended grace. This was the most pivotal moment of my life, the moment he had been waiting for, the moment when I, Regina Forrest, would realize I could no longer be my own God. The moment that I began to turn from a performance-based lifestyle and step into a submission-based life and relationship with Jesus. And oh, thank God, I bet the angels rejoiced that day. She finally got it. And I really think that happened. With that question being truthfully answered, Jesus then proceeded to ask harder questions. "If your marriage marriage never got any better, would you still love me? Would I be enough for you if your husband does not change? Could I be your husband? Would you allow me to love you where he cannot? Would you love your husband for me? Would you lay down your life as a bridge to him? Would you bridge his path to me with your life and allow me to be enough for you?" I'm not going to make this look pretty. Those questions crush my heart. "Jesus, do you know what you're asking of me?" "Yes, my love, I do." I wrestled quite a while with the reality of what Jesus was asking. It was then that he introduced a new word, relinquish. It means to let go. I was faced with letting go of the only way I really knew how to deal with life, and letting Jesus be enough. I had to relinquish my rights, my will, my control, my pain, my fear, and my pride. I remember thinking two things. "I'll just jump. I'll put all my eggs in one basket." And then I answered, "Jesus, I will make you my Lord. I will love you and I will trust you, and I will let you be enough for me." My shattered heart was in deep pain, not only from my circumstances, but from the struggle of relinquishing. It all boiled down to a trust issue. The crux of Jesus being enough is trust. Trust is what will allow you to submit your life to him and make him enough. Making Jesus enough is a very radical move to make, but he loves you so passionately and so jealously. The cross is your example, and it will remind you that surrendering your life is a small offering in comparison. Jesus knows that trusting him and letting him be in charge is the best scenario for our life. So that's kind of the gist of the bridge, how what it really meant was making Jesus enough. I want to share this scripture. It's a scripture that was my go-to scripture during this time. I had had 7 children. I was married all these years. But this scripture is what God uses. It says, "Sing, O childless woman, you have never given birth. Break into loud and joyful song, O Jerusalem, you have never been in labor." And I was barren at the time. Yeah, I lived a fruitful life physically, had all these children. I was married, you know, we had home and all this stuff. But I was barren. I had nothing to offer, nothing to that would give me the strength to be a bridge. It says, "For the desolate woman now has more children than the woman who lives with her husband, says the Lord. Enlarge your house, build an addition, spread out your home, and spare no expense. For you will soon be bursting at the seams. Your descendants will occupy other nations and resettle ruined cities. Fear not, for you will no longer live in shame. Don't be afraid, there is no more disgrace for you. You will no longer remember the shame of your youth and the sorrows of your widowhood. For your Creator will be your husband. The Lord of Heaven's armies is his name. He is your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of the whole earth." He says, "For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with great compassion." It says, "For the Lord has called you back from your grief as though you were a young wife abandoned by her husband." And even though I had my husband, I felt abandoned by him. It says, "For a brief moment I abandoned you, but with great compassion I'll take you back." It says, "For the mountains may move and the hills disappear, but even then my faithful love will remain. My covenant of blessing will never be broken, says the Lord who has mercy on you." So that was the gist of how I kind of got through it. The nitty-gritty on what it looked like that was my go-to scripture, but what it looked like on a daily basis was, I was desperate, and it didn't matter what happened between us. It was a conversation, a look. I would just say, "Jesus, you're enough for me. You've got to be enough for me. Be enough for me in this moment." We would talk. He would say something, and like everything inside me wanted to scream, "You're fake. You're an empty shell." And just like, "Jesus, be enough for me right here." We go to make love. "Jesus, be enough for me right here." Because those are hard things to do. You know, live with someone, cook for him, you know, all the different things you have to do. But at every moment, and probably a trillion times a day, it was like, "Jesus, be enough for me right here." And that's how the bridge thing actually was able to happen. And that was the day-to-day things. Can't even tell you how many years that lasted of doing that. And then it came to a point where, let me go to this. I asked the Lord, I asked him, "How long will you put up with John? When will you have enough of his behavior and his hard heart?" And the Lord just said, "I will never give up on John."
Wow.
He believed in him. He told me, "I believe in him," and that he wanted to heal him. And
wow. And
I believe that the truth, the bottom line of my husband's behavior was brokenness, not selfish, self-centered adultery, but really just the brokenness from his non-nurtured childhood and the wildness that got instilled early on in age, just broken. And Jesus wanted to heal him, not discard him. I wanted to discard him. I was like, "So if I can't divorce him, can you kill him?" Like, I'm not joking.
Seriously.
Because how can I get out of this pain? And the Lord reminded me, this is not about your happiness. This is not about your marital status. This is about your heart. And it was like, oh, this is a lot deeper than I thought. I realized that Jesus was long-suffering with John. And that not only with John, but with me. I was the older brother in this situation. I was the one, like, wanting to kill the man. And asking Jesus to do it for me. And when I saw the long-suffering of God, I saw his tenderness towards him and how he believed in him. He showed it to me through my son. He said, "Would you give up on your son?" It's like, absolutely not. I know who he is. I know his purpose. I know his call. I know the depths of this boy. I see him when he was 7 years old. I know the tenderness. I see him when his sister died. I know who he is. And Jesus said, "That's how I feel about your husband.
Wow.
I love him. I believe in him. I know him." That changed me. And I realized that tenderness he was extending towards me, because I was the one. I didn't believe in him. And I didn't know that unconditional love, but it's that unconditional love that brought me to the point of being able to love him, be a bridge for him.
Okay, oops.
So then, one day, driving in my car, the Lord says, prepare, John's going to die within the year. And I was like, oh, like it was out of the blue, just driving. I remember the part of the road I was on. And so it took, I started preparing and got life insurance. I started getting ready. And I was kind of happy. I was like, gosh, I'm going to have relief from this situation. And all the while I'm working, trying to do what I'm supposed to do. I'm being the bridge the best I can, but I don't exactly get it yet. And every night I'd sit with the Lord and he would say, so what do you want to happen? I'd say, I'm good. I'm good with them going. Next night, what do you want to happen? After a while, I'm like, what do you want to happen, Jesus? He's like, I love him. I want to restore him. Like, and then he told me, if he dies now, he will not go to heaven.
Amen.
And so that's when I realized it's about salvation. It's not about my happiness. And that was the turning point for me to be able to say yes and lay down my life for him, my rights, really.
Mm-hmm.
How did it affect you?
I recognized the shift that took place at that point where...
This was 5 years ago.
This was 5 years ago. Because we'd had one more event, the last and final event of our lives, and I just seen the pain again that I brought her. I saw the suffering, I saw the hurt, the anger, the bitterness. Yet, I also saw the forgiveness that was extended. And I was like done. It's like, you know, Romans 7 in that one, you know, the one where it says, you know, I do the very things that I do not want to do, and the things that I want to do, I don't do. And, you know, but later then it talks about Jesus says, oh, for the sake of Christ. But I was just done. I was just done. And I was like, we were preparing for my daughter's wedding. God's releasing an abundance in our lives. He's bringing jobs out of the blue. I'm like this Israelite that forgets that God loves him, that forgets, you know, that he's feeding him. And I'm just living for self. But yet I saw the pain and I thought, no more, I'm done. I'm done. But it was a selfish done. It wasn't a giving done. And I just decided I was going to kill myself. And I went back into the bedroom and I got my pistol out of the drawer. And I was thinking, okay, I need to figure out how to do this right. Because I didn't want to screw it up. So I figured, you know, I didn't want to mortally wound myself. I wanted to kill myself. I put the gun in my mouth. I put it to my head. I looked around the room. But you can just see the angel of the Lord pulling the gun away, you know, and I looked at the wall and I thought, okay, that's just going to set the stage for Maddie's wedding. It's just, you know, Regina's going to have to come into the room and see the blood and clean up the mess. And I thought, no, I put the gun back in the drawer. I said, I'll push through. We're going to make it. And
that was during the year that the Lord told me he was going to die. And so I didn't know that he was planning to kill himself. And then at the end of the year, the Lord just said, I said, so what happened? He said, no one was ready. And I remember him saying, I saw myself on a road, and he just said, like he picked me up and set me on the side and said, you know what? You're good. You know me. We're close. But now let's work on him. And that's what it was. It was just all energy focused to loving him without conditions, loving him regardless of what he's done, what he will do. There was no guarantee that he was going to change. And just loving him, and that's that change. And then seeing him just as broken, and that's where the shift came.
Yeah, there was a definite shift that took place with that. And I saw that Regina's, that I could see Jesus through her. I could see Jesus in her, and that she was gonna just love me in spite of who I've been. And it brought me to that place where then I was able to begin to change. And from there, I mean, where the word meant nothing to me, now the word began to mean something to me. The word began to come alive in my life. And I'll tell you, I'm not arrived. I'm not there yet. It's like many of us. We're not there, but I'm still working towards it. And
we're all in process.
Yeah, we're all in process. But, you know, thank God for his hand that it reaches so far, his love that's so wide, that, you know, he loves us all, that he's willing to go forever, waiting for us to turn towards Him. You know, it's not a system in cutting it short.
So this summer we met with Paul Kane. Since this is a prophetic meeting, I want to make sure I get this in here. That we met with him, want to ask him, so, you know, do you have any insight? Like, what we're supposed to do? 3 years ago, the Lord reminded me about the word. I was completely off the grid. We disqualified ourselves. We were, like, disqualified, saying we could never do whatever it was we were supposed to do. And then the Lord reminded me, like, you know, this is still on the table. And we reached out to Carl to find out, was the word true? Like, what we've been lied to? And he's like, no, it's true. And so this summer we decided, like, I was just laying in bed one night. I was visiting my friends in Central Coast, and I thought, I'm going to text and see if we can get a meeting with him. And the girl that I, from the healing rooms, Lori Taylor, she just said, well, he doesn't really meet with people, but we'll see. So then she texts right back, oh, yeah, he wants to meet with you, you know. So we get together, we go. And it turned out that his assistant told us his story of how he got a word back the same time we did, and that took 23 years to happen. And he's,
wow.
And then we stayed for a meeting and got two more prophetic words that said, now's the time. There's an effectual open door for you.
Right.
You can't sit still. You have to move. And so all that to say, this whole story to say, it's taken us a long time, but God still had it. He still knew. He still knew what was going to come. And our process was long, but yours doesn't have to be.
Paul and David were having a conversation at the back of the room the night that we received those prophetic words this summer, and he said, you know, Paul told him, there's a time. The time is now, not now. You've missed it, and the time is now.
So that was three, that was in July.
Wow.
That was in August, maybe, July, and we just decided this is it, quit our day job, and here we are.
Wow.
Yeah. So all's not lost. God is in everything. There's no waste. All those years were not wasted.
So, thank you.
Just stay right there.
Okay.
It's kind of like drinking from a fire hose.
Yeah.
It's a big story. But I wanted to give you a chance, if you had the guts, to ask any questions you want to ask these guys. They're prepared to answer those questions. I mean, you know, Regina, like, are you dumber than the dirt? I mean, how did you do this? You know? And you.
Right, there it is.
You
choked me.
Because, I mean, that's what they're going to honestly get.
Right.
People are going to honestly think that she's stupid because she stayed. See, that's true. People are going to think that in their heart. They're going to say it. They'll say it to each other.
Mm-hmm.
But because it isn't a common story. And I mean, I'm one for one that, I mean, she called me one night and told me I can't do it. I said, I get it. You don't have to, you know. And then we had a little bit more of a conversation. But it's an uncommon story. But I think it's a great story, and it's a story of great faith and great faithfulness of God. And then remarkable faith by, you know, you to believe God and trust God and to see it through. So I mean, it's absolutely remarkable for me, being a person that was on that floor wailing like a dog.
Mm-hmm.
I was so scared. I mean, it was like, oh God, you do exist, and you know everything.
Wow.
Keep picking on them. They need it, Lord. So. Do you guys have any questions? A question that comes right to your mind that you want to ask? Yes.
I don't have a question. Thank you for sharing your story. It's not coincidence that I'm here. My middle name is Regina. I am walking in your shoes.
Mm. Wow.
Seriously. The Lord is my husband. The Lord has asked me to separate from him, to push him aside. He's a wild horse right now. They need to corral him, to break him. He's done everything. We don't have kids together. We've got married older. The Lord revealed to me that he's a fake, that he's an actor right now. And so just remember that every time you encounter him, you're at a play. But to listen to the Lord, because he's the director, and to stay focused. You're not stupid. Everybody's telling me, including his family, divorce him. You deserve better.
Absolutely.
And the Lord, I said, no, not until Lord tells me.
No, I completely believe that.
I have to love him through this.
Right.
But in the midst of it, knowing that God's changing my heart.
So it's about your heart, not your marital status.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So
yes.
It's a mirror image.
Yeah.
I just feel like I've met Hosea and Gomer. And I feel like at this time that there will be such a repentance in the church. Because I feel like Jesus is after his bride. And I'm so broken over this because I feel like the church has been playing games too. Not, I'm talking about the American church. I'm not talking about Vineyard, whatever, here. But my heart breaks for the American church. And the timing is so crucial right now. I'm just so blessed that you shared and that you have died to yourselves in order to be transparent, because there's so much show business going on and
absolutely.
Performance, and God wants the heart of the church. He wants his bride.
Good.
Regina, was there a time or a specific thing that the Lord did in you to get you to a place that you believe that John's not going to do this again?
Well, there's probably a few different times. That was always something that I would ask him. And the Lord told me, you can believe in him because I believe in him. Trust me. And so right before the summer when I knew we were going to start to go out, I had that. And like, believe me, fear was my biggest enemy, the biggest wrestling match I've ever had. And I started to get afraid that maybe, you know, we're going to be out on the road, we're going to, you know, go to churches, what's he going to do? And so I started praying. I said, Lord, this is probably horrible prayer, guys. I'm like, you know, if he's not going to make it, can you take him? I'm always praying for that, I guess. But and then he had the heart attack. And he's driving by me in an ambulance, and they're saying, you know, we have the paddles, and we usually revive people. And I just looked, and he's driving by, and I just said, Jesus, is it on the table? Is it still on the table? They said, what do you want to happen?
Wow, come on.
And I said,
come on.
I want to grow old with him. I want to minister with him. I want to do what we're called to do. And he said, before that, he said, he'll go to heaven. And I said, I want him here. I want to do it with him. And so my heart had changed so much. So does that answer your question?
Let me chime in. Yeah, that was roughly nine weeks ago.
Wow.
I had a massive heart attack, and when they're loading me in the ambulance, they're telling her to kiss me goodbye. And they make this statement, oh, but we've got the paddles, you know. Sometimes we lose them, but we usually get them back. And it was this moment, this revelation of, oh, God, I might die in this trip to the other hospital. And I said, Lord, you know, is this it? Is now the time? And I just this moment of, wow, it's where the rubber meets the road. And I said, Lord, if you want to take me, I'm okay with it, but I really want to stay, and I want to do what we've been called to do.
Wow.
Because we knew, we'd already talked to Carl. We knew, you know, we were winding down our business to quit my day job and step out. And we both had that moment. Yeah. There was somebody back there, actually, further back.
Right. Thank you for sharing. So,
and speak up, Maria.
My question is, you say that your journey was really long and that others don't have to have such a long journey. Was there anything in your story and your journey that you would encourage anybody else to do differently that might shorten that trajectory of healing?
Yes, and I have notes on that, but I think we've talked way too long. So, yes, this is the difference. John, that night, 28 years ago, they said, you'll no longer be known as Kevin, but St. John. Jesus did that 28 years ago. Jesus saw him 28 years ago as John. It took John decades to figure out that that's who he was. It took me decades to figure out that that's who he was. The difference is knowing who you are,
yeah.
in Christ and knowing what the cross has provided for you. The scripture says that he changes every wilderness into a Garden of Eden. Jesus did that on the cross. It is done. Our job, to walk in it. If we had walked in the truth of the cross, the resurrection, and lived that life, and known who we were, that we are children of God, that we don't deal with fear. The Red Sea's parted before us. That's who we are. If we had known that, different story.
Yeah.
We didn't start owning that. When we started to own it, that's when things changed.
Walk out the faith to believe it.
Okay. All right, I'm gonna interview these guys tomorrow, and I'll ask them some questions. And they'd like to know what they are.
He's not telling us.
But that's not the way I work.
I'm like, get ready.
Is your book going to be available?
Oh, let me talk about that.
Yeah.
This is it. John and I had no idea that these were going to sell like they have. And so we had a bunch when we got here, and we had a bunch waiting to come. And so we don't have that many now because they sold when we were the last week when we were in Santa Maria. And so we do have some to sell. The other thing we're going to do, because you can buy it on Amazon, and it's $14.99 plus $3.99 with shipping. And there's also a study guide. It's $9.99, and it kind of walks through every chapter, and it's broken up kind of nice. And we will sell them today, and if we run out of books, we have like 15 back there. I'm so sorry. And we have some to sell tomorrow, but 15. And so we will take orders, and you can pay for them today, and then we'll mail them to you, and you won't have to pay shipping as if you just bought it here. That's what we want to do. So there's some order forms back
and
there.
And you'll sign those ones.
And I can sign the book, and I can sign them, the ones I send to you, if that means anything. I always like, why do people want you to sign it? But hey. Yeah, so it's an amazing book. And the thing is, we're only with you for 2 hours today and an hour tomorrow or something like that. But this is the meat of what happened. This is my story. It doesn't say that much about our marriage other than what God called me to do and how it happened. It's called Thirsty Heart, Nourishment for a Dehydrated Soul, and it's the basis of God, how he healed and transformed my life. So I say get it, because then you can have it every day, and you've heard us speak, and you can go, okay, this is what she was talking about.
Very good. Okay. We are going to wind up, because we have another thing coming up, and I want to give you time for that. What time do you start?
12:15, but I need to be in there earlier.
Okay, they start 12:15, so those of you who are going to Ark to Heal, those of you who aren't, you're welcome to stay around and talk to these guys, ask them any questions you want to ask them. They're going to be with us tomorrow. It'll be like a 30-minute interview, but I am going to talk to him about splits and how you manage those, because that's something we do in the church incredibly well. And what Char was saying is right. I mean, we just have a lot of people, and it's not the environment, you know, to do it in. I mean, you're not going to be pouring your guts out, you know, on Sunday morning. But that's why relationships are important. That's why small group settings are important. Ministering together are important, because that's when you have a chance to say, hey, I need help. And or to be able to just tell the truth about who you really are. Because, you know, all of us see each other. I mean, just as we see the best part of each other. I mean, every picture we put on Facebook or on Twitter, all that, there are the happy times, you know. There are not times when we're fighting or acting out or sneaking around. And we've learned to do that really well in the church, and it is getting old. I don't appreciate it at all. I don't like having to be what people think I should be, and I don't like other people acting towards me like they think I think they should be. I want us to be who we are in Jesus, and he is enough. Mm-hmm. He is enough, and sometimes it's really ugly, and sometimes it's really difficult. And that's why this story has always stood out to me. Because I was there, and it was the most terrifying moment I've ever had with a group of Christians ever, because God's presence was so real in the room, and it was so frightening. And then I, of course, my life had been so intertwined with theirs. I knew everything about them, and I'd been very close to them. So to see, you know, see what was going on was very amazing to me. And it was the most powerful thing I've ever experienced in the life of the church. And yet, here we are, 30 years later, starting to see it blossom and see the fruit of that word that was given in a moment, very powerfully, in such a way that people thought, oh, it's done, it's over. You know, no, it was just the flipping beginning.
Right.
And that's the way it is a lot of times.
Yeah.
And it's not always that way. Nothing nothing in the church is always one way or another.
Right.
We kind of get at this, this is how God does it. You don't know, diddly. We don't know how God is going to do things. We recognize some things and we see some things, but it's still, we only see a little bit of it. We see through a glass dimly. And because he's gracious, he doesn't show us the whole thing. I mean, if you would have seen at that time, hey, I'm doing this breakthrough right now, but it's going to be 30 years before you're going to see the fruit of it. It might have been pass. You know?
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm not doing that one.
Yeah. So it's a good story, man, and it's good for all of us. I think God's faithfulness is demonstrated in it. And so I'm just going to pray for him, and then we'll break. And those of you who have to move on to Art to Heal, go ahead. Yeah. And by the way, you know, I just visited the facility that we're looking at, and it looks very, very good. It's only a mile away from here, and it's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful setting. You know, creeks and ponds and trees, and it's a nice building. And really, the Chinese are buying it, and they just want us to come along, very much so. And that's why they asked to come over there and look at everything. What do we want? Do you want this? Do you want that? And, I mean, they're very, very gracious towards us, and that's just the favor of the Lord, and it's good fortune for us. I mean, I like it a lot. You know, so anyway, kiddos, please bless you. Extend your hand. Lord, all the things that we think or say about you are true. You're faithful, you're long-suffering, you're kind, you're gracious, you're merciful, and we can't outrun you. We can't outlast you. You're relentless in your pursuit of us, and you're relentless in your love of us. And so, Lord, we thank you for that example of that in John and Regina. And how it speaks to our hearts, it speaks to our lives, it speaks to our situation. Lord, raise up within us hope and raise up within us faith. And allow us, Lord, give us the strength to be long-suffering. You said it's one of the fruits of your spirit, is to be long-suffering. And so, Lord, manifest your fruit in our midst, Lord. Love and patience, kind, endurance, Lord. Mm. All of it, Lord. We just bless you. We thank you for these two. We thank you for the family. Yes. And we pray your favor and your blessing upon them the rest of their days, Lord. And we pray, Lord, that you would use the death that they've died to bring life to many.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Yeah. Thank you.